Good morning, church. Praise the Lord, everybody. We can stand to our feet this beautiful day. How many of you are blessed to be in the house of God this morning? How many of you are blessed? Come on, are you blessed? We are blessed to be in the house of God this morning. We be together to worship and magnify Him. And it's always a great time when we come together, and this is why. Out of the many things that God does, one of the things that He loves is when people unite. When the body of Christ comes together and worship and magnify Him. The scripture says, where two or three are gathered, there I am. If two or three come in agreement, I will do it. So there's a beautiful thing when we're together, and not just together, but also in agreement. So I invite you to be in agreement this morning. To be in agreement that He is God of everything. He is our Lord and our Savior. And that whatever desires of our heart, if our heart lines up with the will of the Father, His will, that He will do it. But there is something that you've been asking God. Maybe that thing you've been asking God, you're feeling deep, you feel deep down inside, like, God, I know this is what I want, but I have a sense that maybe it's not what you have for me, Father. Maybe what you have for me is a different direction. Maybe you thought God was going to answer a prayer a certain way at a certain time frame, and God is saying, just, there's something I'm working out in your life right now. There's something I'm doing in your life. I'm building you up. I'm making you stronger. I know you thought you had it figured out, but you don't. And there's things in life that God puts us through. There's things in life He shows us and He reveals to us. And right when we think we figured it out, right when we think like we graduated and we feel like, yes, God, I made it through my process. Boom, it comes, something else comes. Bobby, there's something that God is working in us. He is trying to perfect us every single day in our lives. And that's why it seems like when you just made some progress, it feels like you took three steps forward and then you took a couple of steps back. Why? Because God is working something in me, in our families, in our homes, in our character. So today I ask you just to, let's come in agreement and say, God, let my desires be your desires. That whatever it is that you're wanting to do, you do it today, this morning, Heavenly Father. Have your way. Even if it hurts us, if there's things He has to purge out of us, if there's mindsets that have to be transformed, may God start doing that today, this morning. So let's come together in agreement this morning. Heavenly Father, we come before your presence, God, in agreement. In agreement with one another that you are God, you are Lord and Savior, you are Creator of all things, Father. And God, I ask you, God, you help our hearts' desires, Father. You say you will, if we ask of anything, you will do it, Father. And you know the desires of our hearts, Father. But we understand also, God, that the desires of our heart does not mean the desires of our flesh, but that our heart may be connected to you, Father. And that our desires become your desires, Jesus. That there are things that need to be transformed in us today, that through this singing and worshiping you, Father, that you begin just to move in our minds and our hearts, God. You begin just to break down barriers that have existed maybe inside of us, Lord. Things that we've held back and we're holding back from you. We're trying to hide from you, God. And we don't even know we're trying to hide, but they are there, hidden, Father. That you break every single barrier, Father. And that today, God, you bring revelation to our minds, our hearts, God, of things that you are trying to do in us and perfect in us. No matter if it hurts, God, if it feels uncomfortable, God, when we come in agreement that you do your perfect will in our lives. Have your way this service, God. We worship you. We honor you. We praise your holy name. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, church. We're so glad to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. There's a special anointing here in this place. And like my brother was saying, that there's nothing impossible for God. As we enter into this time of worship, forget about everything that you have in the back, in the house. Let's just let God have this moment. Amen. We all benefit from everything now, the word and the giving, but God takes all the glory right now. Amen.
Come down and shout it out.
There is power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. We praise you. We praise you. We praise you, God, because you are amazing, powerful.
Yeah.
thought he had us. The enemy thought we were done for. But God turned it around and made it all for our good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the reason we can come in here and say, if it had not been for the Lord, hallelujah, who was on my side, glory to God, hallelujah. Lift up your hands right there and just thank him for that. Just thank him for being right there with you. Just thank him for being by your side on this terrible moments. Hallelujah. I don't understand sometimes why I go through the things that I do, but I thank him that he's with me. I thank him that he's always with me. Hallelujah. He is power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you, Jesus. What a powerful name. Hallelujah. What a powerful name.
Thank you.
so much power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Sometimes it becomes so common to say Jesus. It comes so casual to just say Jesus. But there's no other name that can bring salvation to your soul than the name of Jesus. That's how powerful Jesus' name is. Hallelujah. This is the reason he said, you know, when you ask in the name of Jesus, and everything shall be done. Why is it that sometimes we don't see it? It's because we don't give Jesus the right power that we should. When we say the name of Jesus, sometimes we're thinking John or Juan or Carlos. This, we're talking about the name of the creator of the heaven and the earth. Hallelujah. Before Jesus was born, there was only Yeshua, Jehovah. But when he was manifested in flesh, hallelujah, when the God Almighty, who created everything that you see and everything that you don't see, hallelujah, he gave himself a name, and the name is Jesus. Hallelujah. This is the reason that when I say the name of Jesus, hallelujah, everything has to come in order, hallelujah. And the demons tremble by the name of Jesus, hallelujah. What a wonderful name, hallelujah. What a wonderful name of Jesus, hallelujah. Oh, Jesus on the mountains, Jesus on the streets, Jesus over every enemy. Come on, say that. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Why do I have to speak Jesus to my family? Because believe it or not, our kids sometimes are living a double life. We don't even know that they're smoking weed. Come on. We don't even know that they're doing all these other things that we think they're not doing. But this is the reason we speak the name of Jesus in our family. Why? Because the demon of that, whatever it is that they're struggling, has to flee from our house. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, parents. Somebody in here gotta know what I'm talking about. Somebody in here gotta know that you've seen what's going on in your family. And you know what's going on, that there's something going on in your life and your kids' life, that we must apply the name of Jesus, hallelujah. We must apply the blood of the Lamb that will cover everybody in our house. Come on, lift up your hands and say, just say Jesus. Everybody just say Jesus, cover me. Jesus, cover me this morning. Jesus, cover my kids. Jesus, cover my son, my daughter. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. It's a generational demon that is after my family, and I apply the name of Jesus over them. Hallelujah. Because I know the struggle. I've been there. Hallelujah. I've been there.
If you can, wherever you're at, if you can just hold hands with your neighbor, hold hands with your family next to you. If your children, you're here, your siblings are here, hold hands with your siblings. If you have, you're not here with anybody, find somebody and just connect with somebody right now. We're going to declare the name of Jesus over our families, over our loved ones, over all of our lives, our homes. That no matter what darkness, what enemy is trying to come against you, trying to infiltrate your home, infiltrate your life, the blood of Jesus is upon you. And Jesus will cover you. So Heavenly Father, right now, God, we unite, Father, with all the families, all the friends. God, we unite for each other. And we're declaring the blood of Jesus over our families, God, over our homes, over our city, God. We're coming together in agreement, God, knowing that the gates of hell are trying to come against, but it will not prevail, Father, because you are with us, Father. You are our strong tower, Lord. We are covered under the shadow of the Almighty Father, Lord. So right now we submit before your shadow, God. We submit before your covering, God. We submit before you, Father. Send angels to camp around us, your heavenly angels to camp around our children, God, our family, God, in our workplaces, God, day and night, Father, that when the enemy wants to come and he wants to destroy, he wants to bring confusion, Lord, we rebuke him in the name of Jesus Christ. He will not prevail. He cannot prevail, Father. God, right now we stand up as a hedge, God, of God's people. We are lifting up our prayers, God, before you, God. Be with my brother, be with my sister, with my niece, my nephew, with my children, with my wife, God. Be with our family and our loved ones, God. Bring covering and protection, God, that whenever we try to get away from you, Father, that you bring us back to you, Jesus. Whenever we are distracted and confused and we have lost heart, we have lost strength, Father, that you bring strength into us. You renew our strength, Father. You renew our mind, God, and you bring clarity and focus in our spirit, Father, that we not walk by God by sight, but we walk by faith, Father. We don't live this life by what we see and by what we feel, God, but we live it by what is true in you, Father. So, God, have your way in our families, God. Have your way, God. Have your way, Jesus. We declare the name of Jesus Christ over our lives, over our families, over our home. Every person that comes into our home, God, every person we come in contact to, Father, that we declare the blood of Jesus over them. We preach the gospel. There is power in the preaching of the gospel, Lord. And that we no longer be scared and fearful, God, of preaching the gospel. And I sense this really strong right now for many of us here today, that we get scared to preach the gospel. We get scared to seek God all the way, because we know what happens when we begin to seek God and we begin to put our trust in God. We know the enemy doesn't like that. And we know the enemy will come stronger and things begin to happen. But I want to encourage you, that is a testing of your faith. That when you declare the word of God, you declare the gospel over people's life, if God is the creator of all things, if God is in charge of all things, no matter what comes your way, how it makes you feel, you overcome it in Jesus' name. It is a tactic of the enemy to try to keep you scared of him, keep you fearful, keep you bound. Because if you don't truly live for God, if you don't open up your mouth, you're not fulfilling God's commission. And he's trying to keep us from fulfilling God's commission. He's trying to keep us from living the life that God, he desires for us. And he's keeping us comfortable. He's keeping us at bay. Just, we're okay with coming to church, but there's more to just coming to church. So today, when Pastor comes and he preaches the word of God, I believe it's going to be a word of God that is going to transform our lives. And if we allow the word to be planted into our spirits, that it will blossom, it will grow to be something fruitful. And by fruitful, it's not just having a good quality of life, but by fruitful, that there's people that are coming to Christ, that you, your family, is growing in Christ, that the things that you struggled with last year are not the same things you're struggling this year. That every day that passes, you're drawing closer and closer to God. You're being made more into his perfect image. We'll never be perfect here on earth, but every day we have the ability to come before the throne of God and allow him to perfect us, allow him to work in us, to work on our temper, on our character, to change us and transform us. So we are so grateful that you are here this morning. You can have your seats for a brief moment. We are so grateful for all our friends and our visitors. Can we just give a round of applause to all of our visitors and our friends? We thank you for joining us. We are thankful you've chosen us, chosen to be here at our local church. And our desire for you is that you just find God. You're here today, and we are honored to have you. But you're not here just to listen to beautiful music and listen to a good word and make you feel good. But we're believing you're here to receive something supernatural. Receive a word from God through the man of God who will be speaking today. And that God is actively working in this place through his spirit. He can work in you. And it's God is not a genie. God is not somebody we come to. We ask three wishes and he grants it. No, that's not God is. God is one we come to. We submit our will to the Father, and he does his perfect will in us. And he transforms our hearts and our minds. You know, we may ask God, take away this, take away that. I don't want to go through this. And God is saying, like, no, you need to go through it. So God is a just God. He's a faithful God. He's creator of all things. And if he's creator of all things, there's nothing impossible for him. There's nothing too impossible for him that he cannot transform your heart. Maybe your situation may remain the same, but there's going to be something inside of you that's going to be just transformed and changed. You were walking in sadness and depression, but now you're walking in joy. And you may ask, why, God? Why is there so much joy inside of me when my situation still remains the same? It is his Holy Spirit that is transforming and changing you. Because something we can't control is other people. We can't control things in life. But all we control is our surrendering to God. And say, God, I surrender to you. As my kids are growing up, I can't control my children as they're getting older. Eventually, they're going to leave my house. We're thinking about it. We're like, man, it's going to happen really soon. I get a little sad. I'm like, oh, God, help me, you know? You know, but the truth is we can't control any of that. But all we could do is say, God, I surrender myself. And you're in control. That's all we can do. And remain. And maybe the things that happen in our lives, I mean, stuff I'm going through, we're all going through stuff. And maybe those things, I know why they happen. They happen so we can remain connected to God. That the moment we start thinking, like, I got this under control, I'm doing well. It's like, no, like, we got to understand all things come from God. All good things come from God. He's the only one that is good. Nothing that we're not good, but God is good. And all things come from him. So maybe the things you're going through is God is saying, you know what? He's trying to get your attention. He's saying, son, daughter, it's time for you now. And maybe this morning it's your time. This morning is your time where God is going to get hold of you. He's going to change you and transform you. And this morning could be your time where you're going to have that encounter with God like you've never had it before. Amen. Do y'all believe that? Amen. Amen. Jesus' name. I'm going to ask the ushers if you can pass around. We have a few ways to give here. One of our sisters will come up here to the side, and you'll be able to give offering. If you need an envelope, you can ask for an envelope. And as we're giving, I'm going to ask you guys just to remain sitting. I'm going to go over some announcements today. Very important. After service, we will have lunch, breakfast tacos. All right, it's super important food. All right, so we want to encourage you. Our nursery is actually sponsoring today's lunch and breakfast. And I don't know if you look around, especially if you come to Spanish service, even here, you know, but man, we have a lot of young couples with young kids, and nursery ministry is very important. It is huge. And I know some of you guys who've already are over the age where you no longer have little kids, and it was a different time. We were maybe built a little bit different. When I was growing up, and my kids were growing up, right, at least my oldest one, there wasn't like social media. There wasn't like tablets, and every kid had an iPhone. It was a different time. And then my first son, he was just calm. So, I mean, I were blessed with my first son. Second and third one, God tricked us on the first one. But the second and third one were a little bit crazier, but we were blessed, and it was pretty easy. I mean, by the grace of God, he just helped us with the first one. It was very calm. You know, but one thing that always is a blessing is when parents can trust a nursery to, like, watch children. When parents can, you know, put their kids in nursery and there's care being taken, there's a good facility for them where the parents can receive from God. I mean, y'all remember when y'all were parents and sleepless nights, financial struggles, you're fighting, you're arguing, and it's like you're always stressed, you're always tense. Like, I remember those times. You know, like, you're always just upset at each other with your spouse, and you're fighting, you're arguing, and the church is supposed to be your place of, like, all right, I'm going to receive the word of God, and then your child's misbehaving. And you're like, not even at church, I can, like, have a good time. All right? So nursery is super huge. It is very important. So you're giving. Like, you can pass up if you can pass up and give your offerings and tithes. But you're giving here, but even, like, supporting these ministries. So today, like, if you don't typically eat tacos, I encourage you to go over to the gym and order some tacos, or just donate. If you're not going to eat, just donate $20. You know, it's very important for this nursery ministry. It's a ministry that's very important here, so we encourage you to donate. As well tonight, if you weren't aware, today we're doing God Bless Houston. It's the first one of this year. We're going to be at Herman Park. All the young people are invited. So it's for all the young people. We're going to go evangelize, pray for people. We're going to minister to people. But like always, we invite parents. Parents, please support. It's going to be at 6 p.m. at Herman Park. We'll be meeting right by the fountains or where the water is at. In that area right in the middle of Herman Park. That's where we always meet. It'll be at 6 p.m. today. We encourage you, go support. If you don't want to go walk around with the young people and pray, that's fine. If you're just there and supervise, there's always a group that stays back and just sings songs and worships God. If you can just be there, maybe we'll need some help with, like, water bottles. We'll need some help with certain things. So we always need help. We always need your support. So it'll be today at 6 p.m. Also, if you feel in your heart to ever donate for God Bless Houston, Sister Diana's not here this morning, but you can see Sister Diana. She's one of our worship leaders here. She's the one who organizes God Bless Houston. You can get with her, get with some of the youth committees, and then they can give you more information how to be a part of God Bless Houston. So today at 6 p.m., we encourage you to be there. Of course, we have our Monday prayer, Wednesday gathering for all the young people. Come, be here. It is a great time in the Lord. As well as today after our service out in the lobby, there will be registration. There's a conference happening next month in San Antonio. It's a conference for home groups. So there's going to be more information out in the lobby. You can register, and if you want more information, just go out there and you can get more information regarding that. I'm going to invite you. We can stand to our feet. We're going to pray for our offering, and with this prayer, we're going to turn this place over to our pastor, who will bring the message today. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all that you do, Lord. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to be able to give this morning. That you're always faithful, God, even though we're not faithful, Lord. But we're going to be faithful, God. Not just in our attending church, God, but even in our giving. Not just in our worshiping you and lifting up our holy hands, Father, but in honoring you, God, with our offerings and our tithes, Father. There is something beautiful that happens, Father, when we give to you. We give sacrificially. There is something that money does, Father, when we release it, Father. It's not an idol to us, Father. It's just a means of resources, Father. So we pray, God, that as we're giving, it could be a resource to the church, God, to do your perfect will. That you continue to lead our church and the leadership, God, to use those resources, Father, for your glory, for your honor, that your kingdom is preached. That the expanding of your kingdom, God, here in our community, it continues to grow and move, Father, and lives are transformed and changed, God, every day. We're believing that, and I pray a blessing over every family, every person who is giving today, even who is not giving. Bless them, be with them. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God bless you, Pastor, with us. Give God a hand, praise.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Give that hand clap, that hand praise to the Lord this morning. Come on, clap your hands unto the Lord one more time. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we love you. Lord, we praise you this morning. We thank you for the life you've given us. Thank you, Lord, for taking care of us, protecting us, Lord God, and for us being here this morning in your presence, Father. For without a shadow of a doubt, we know that you are in this place this morning. Praise the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 How many believe that the Lord is in this place? Yes, he is. He's in this house. And I am so thankful to God to be here this beautiful day in the presence of our Lord. Hallelujah. So how many are joyful this morning? Happy to be in the house of God. Has God been good to you? I want to make sure that you're doing good. Amen. That you're rejoicing in the presence of the Lord, the Lord has been good to everyone. Praise God. God is faithful. No matter what happens and what happens in the world, As you well know, what's happening in the world, there's some serious stuff going on in the Middle East right now. So we must all pray for the peace. But then again, God is in control of all things. Amen? So what's happening, happened yesterday in Israel, being attacked by Iran, that's something very serious that's happening in the world. And it affects everyone. It affects the whole world. And we don't know what's next. That's why we have to pray. We have to pray that God will protect, first of all, the nation of Israel. That is His people. And we must pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And pray for all the victims. Pray for all the state leaders, governors, presidents that are involved in all this conflict. That God may have mercy and may God lead them in making the right decisions. But pray for our country. Pray for our president. Because it does, I can just imagine the pressure he's feeling at this moment in making these tough decisions of what's happening next in our world. And also, if we look at the prophetic clock, if we look at prophecy, all this is in the book. It's in the Bible. It's due to happen. We don't know if this is the end or not, but it's going to happen. It's going to happen. So that's why we have to pray, and that's why we also have to be right with God. Amen. Make sure that we're right with God, in case if this is the end, if we're looking at World War III, we need to be right with God. Amen. Be in God's hands. God will protect us, keep us safe. They're talking about that. They're talking about this being possibly World War III taking place, because it all depends on what Israel decides to do at this moment. If they decide to defend themselves, as they are, they have all the right to do that, then it could get very, very, very ugly. But anyway, praise God. We're here in the house of God. We're not going to let that worry us. And life goes on, and we must continue to move forward. And we praise the Lord for everything He's done. Amen. So today is also, I believe you did mention it, Brother Ben, Spring Pledge Sunday. As you well know, we postponed it a few weeks. And today is the date that we will take time to pick up some spring pledges. And we have a presentation for you. Therefore, I need to get into the Word of God so that we can have enough time to do everything this morning. Praise the Lord. So as you stand, let us go to the Word of the Lord. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 1 and 2. Again, we're going to preach the Word of God. We're going to make an altar call, a call to action. You come up if you feel in your heart that you need to come up for prayer. The altar will be open. And then after that, we'll have a short presentation to give you a report of 2023 Spring Pledge, and then present to you the needs that we have this year and where we need your help. But 1 Samuel 30, verse 1 and 2 says, "Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way." I want to speak to you for a few moments, recovering what the enemy stole from us. Jesus, help me to preach this word, to preach and say the words that our people need to hear, Father, this morning. Bless every single person in this building. Bless our visitors. Bless our brothers in Christ. Everyone here, from the youngest to the oldest, that we may receive this word, Lord, this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You may be praising God as I preach the word for a few moments. And we see in the Bible that there's many stories that we find where there were men who lost everything. Men that lost everything, yet through it all, they were able to see the hand of God. In spite of them losing what they had, God helped them to recover what they had lost. There's another person in the Bible that comes to mind, and that is Job. When you study the life of Job, Job was a man that lost everything. He lost his family. He lost his land. He lost his livestock. He lost everything. He was the richest man in those days, and he lost it all. He lost it all. But yet, one thing he did not lose was his faith in God. And therefore, God, and he did not deny God. He did not curse God for what happened to him. And on the other hand, or instead, he worshiped God and he praised God and he continued to believe in God. Therefore, God recovered everything and gave him even more of what he had when he first started. And it happens to us even today. The same happens nowadays too. And the plan of God helps us to recover what we have or whatever we've lost. God can help us. Brother Ben was speaking about, Brother Jesse was also talking about how, the devil wants to take away, steal what God has given us. Brother Ben was mentioning the family, speaking about the kids. And that's one area where the devil always wants to take our kids. In this story, we see that David and his men were out. They weren't with their family. They weren't in their own city. They were out fighting a battle. But when they returned back to their home, they came to a place that was in ruins. The city was burnt down. It was a terrible situation. And they have taken all of his family. They took his wives and they took his kids, his servants, everything. But one thing we see here that I'm amazed how they took them captive. They burnt Ziklag with fire. And they took the women and they took the kids, the children captive. Small and great, young and old. But it's interesting to see that the Bible says that they did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way. You see, it reminds me again of Job. When God asked Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" Satan said, "Well, of course I have." I'm paraphrasing the scripture. "But I can't touch him because you're protecting him." So then God gives the enemy the opportunity, authority to take everything from Job. But the only thing he would not be able to take from Job was his life. You can take all the material things, but you can't touch his soul. You can't touch his life. You're not going to destroy him completely. It reminds me, as I read this story, how the enemy came and the Amalekites took David's family, but they did not kill them. Why? Because even though it seems like a terrible situation, God is still in control of this situation. And God puts limits, and there's boundaries that are set to the enemy. He can only go so far. If you are concerned about your children, if you're concerned about a situation in your life right now, I want to tell you from God speaking to us this morning, that you don't have to cry and worry about that. God's hand is still with them. Why? Because they are under the promise. They're under the covenant. When God promises something, He fulfills it. He keeps His promise. If God said that you and your family would serve the Lord, then yes, your family and your children will serve the Lord. Even if your child is out and about and living in the world and being rebellious, it's just a matter of time. You keep praying. You keep trusting God. Keep believing in His word, and it will come to life. God will bring them to His feet. The devil can take away material things. The devil can even take away can take away your joy. He can take away your peace. But one thing the devil can't do, he can't touch your soul. Because God's hand is over you. He's over your family. And we see it here in this story that we're reading. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But let me just share with you. Here we see the enemy attacking God's people. And the same story repeats itself today. The devil still continues to attack God's people. And he's attacking us. He's attacking you. He's trying to make you give up. Especially as he knows that his days are counted. The end is near. Judgment will come. And the devil wants to keep you from entering heaven. He's trying to discourage you from walking this glorious walk in God's presence. But it is up to us to understand that if God promised it, He's gonna come through. He's gonna help us no matter what the devil has taken away from you. You are going to recover it in Jesus' name. You will see that child return to your house. You will see those rebellious kids that don't want to serve God. You will see them in the house of God, praising the name of Jesus. You will see your finances get better at home. Even though we're living in tremendous times, the economy is not doing well out there. That's what the reports say out there. The economists, the experts on economy are saying that. But let me ask you this. Whose report are you going to believe? Are you going to believe what the economist is saying? Or are you going to believe what the Word of God says? Oh, I need you to help me preach this morning. I only have a few minutes to preach. So whose report will you believe? We've got to stand firm on God's promises that He will supply all of our needs according to His riches in glory. So I don't care what the economists say. I don't care what the prices are out there. The gasoline's going up. The food's going up. Everything's going up. Praise the Lord. But I'm going to keep trusting God in what He says, that He promises to supply all of my needs. Blessed be the name of Jesus. But the enemy of our life, the Bible says that the devil, that lying devil, John says, Jesus speaking, says the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. That's the devil's mission. He's out to steal and to kill and destroy. He wants to steal our joy. He wants to steal our peace. He wants to steal your children. He wants to kill our dream. He wants to kill and destroy our ministry. The devil's out to get us. But today I've got news for the devil. I'm going to recover everything he has taken away from me. Hallelujah. Because God has said it. I believe it. It's mine. So when are we most, I guess we can use the word, vulnerable to being robbed by the enemy? When is it that you feel that the enemy is always attacking you and always causing problems in your home? Have you noticed that when you determine that you're going to serve God better, when you determine that you're going to, you know, get serious about serving God and leave worldliness behind and just focus on your personal relationship with Jesus. And you made up your mind that this time you're going to be serious. That's when the devil comes and attacks you. That's when the devil wants to stop you from serving God more and better. And when you start thinking about these things, it depresses you because you say, now that I'm being more serious, now that I've determined this year, I made up my mind that I was going to go to church more. I was going to pray. I was going to read the Word of God. I was going to be obedient. I was going to do everything as right as possible as I can. And now here, look at me where I'm at right now. And that, as human beings, it will discourage you. It will bring you grief. It weakens you because the devil is trying to destroy us from within. You know, he's trying to destroy you from within, from your heart. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible tells us that we must guard our hearts. Of all things guarded, we must guard our heart because that's where the devil wants to work. He wants to discourage you. He wants you to fall in depression. He wants you to keep focusing on everything that's going wrong, everything that God has not done for you. That's how the devil begins to work in your mind. He wants to rob your joy, your peace, and at the end destroy you completely. And that's when we're most vulnerable. The thief comes to steal at night. When you least expect them, he sneaks into your home and he robs you from the things that belong to you, and you feel like you've been violated. You feel terrible that someone coming into your home. I'm talking about the physical or the material aspect, the earthly aspect, but it applies to the spirit too, to the emotional too. When the devil comes and he begins to mess with you and he begins to steal your joy, you begin to believe his lies. Depression comes in, discouragement comes in, and there the devil has accomplished his purpose. Praise the name of the Lord. When does the devil come to attack you the most? When are you most vulnerable? When you're trying to serve God the most. When you decided, I'm going to serve him better. And when the devil sees that you are building something greater than yourself. What do I mean by this? God has given us promises. We all have a potential, a calling so great even ourselves do not understand how great that is in our what's in our hearts, what God has deposited in us. We are children of God, and we can accomplish a lot, and the devil knows that. The devil knows that you are a great asset for the kingdom of God. Therefore, that's why he tries to stop you. The enemy attacks you when you're trying to build the kingdom of God, or you're doing something to bless others. When you're working and when you're focusing on your ministry, on your calling, on serving God, on doing something for the kingdom of God, the devil says, oh no, this guy or this girl, they are a threat to me. I must stop that. And that's when he comes and he tries to steal things from you. Steal things that God has given you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. But the devil is a liar and the devil is defeated. Blessed be the name of Jesus. I'm here to expose the devil. I'm telling the devil, you've been caught. You came to steal and you've been caught red-handed, and we're going to take back what you have taken away from us, that the Lord has given us. What we have, the world didn't give it to us, much less the devil gave it to us. Therefore, if the devil and the world didn't give it to us, well, they cannot take it away. Hallelujah. How many say amen this morning? Praise be the name of the Lord. So let me hurry up this morning. Not only is there a spiritual warfare going on, there's also a psychological warfare. And it's presented by the enemy. And what is the purpose of this psychological warfare? The enemy is trying to stop you from trusting God, from believing in his promises. Begins to put all these thoughts in your mind. Because he knows that if he succeeds, he can stop you from reaching your potential, from being a blessing to others. You know, the devil also destroys the trust between you and the leaders of the church, the people in the church. The devil knows that if he can succeed in this, his plan is to divide. And a divided church will not accomplish much. A divided church, a divided body of Christ, is an idle body of Christ. You're not moving forward. You're not active. You're dying if you're divided. And the devil knows that. And that's why he begins to mess with your mind. There's a psychological warfare to make you, to put thoughts in your heart so that you won't trust your leader, so that you won't trust the people, the leadership in the church, because the ultimate goal is to divide the church. And how does he do this? He does it by sowing seeds of doubt in your life as a believer. So he sows seeds of doubt concerning the leadership of the church, the people in the church, and vice versa. The devil also tries to darken your vision. Satan will try to make God's promises seem like, you know, they're insignificant. They're small. They're not important. You never accomplish them. That's the enemy's goal. He's trying to darken our vision so that we won't be able to see clearly how great God's vision for this church is, how significant it is, how powerful it is. The vision for this church is to win souls for Christ, to save the lost that are out there dying without hope. And I thank God for our young people, this great work that they're doing, evangelistic work that they're doing tonight, this evening, of going out to the downtown Houston and speaking and sharing the gospel, the good news of salvation, letting people know that Jesus loves them and that there's still hope for them, even in this chaotic world that we're living in. Jesus is still the answer. We have a great vision for this church, and the devil knows it. And that's why the devil is trying to darken the vision of our saints by putting all kinds of thoughts in your mind so that you will lose trust and not believe and not trust the Lord, and do not believe that what God has given us is great, and what God has promised us is significant. It is awesome and it is great. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So, to recover what the enemy takes from us, we must first of all start by reading the Word of God, because it is in the Word of God that we will find God's promises for us. Praise the Lord. And declare his promise after reading God's promises and knowing what God has for you and me. Now we have to declare those promises and say, these are for me and for my family. I receive them in the name of Jesus. And then you've got to fight for them until they become a reality. How many say praise the Lord this morning? You've got to be willing to fight for those promises. Hallelujah. You've got to fight for those promises. And then never forget to be thankful, to give praise, and to thank God for your blessings. This in itself summarizes David's story that we just read. What did David do when the enemy took from him all his wealth? He took from him all his joy, and he even took his family. The Bible says, when we read this story, that David's faith was strengthened as he waited for his promise and he sought direction from God. He didn't throw a pity party and blaming others for the failures he was going through, the terrible time. No, the Bible says in 1 Samuel 30, verse 8, so David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered him, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without fail recover all. Should I pursue them, God? Should I go after the Amalekites? They've just taken my wealth. They've taken my joy because they've taken my family. Lord, shall I pursue them? And God answered David and gave him a promise. He told him, go, follow them, pursue them, because you will recover. That's God's promise there. You're going to recover everything that the devil has taken from you. And we see David's faith being strengthened as he waits on that promise. He believed God when God spoke to him and told him, go after them, because you will recover everything that the enemy has taken. David believed that promise, and he was strengthened by that promise. And as he waited on that promise to be fulfilled, that promise is not going to happen on our time. It's not going to happen the way we want it to happen. It's going to happen in God's time and the way God wants it to happen. But our job is to keep trusting God. Our job is to keep believing God. And in the process, he will strengthen us to wait on that promise to come to fruition. It will happen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So here we see David. He pursued not only him, but he took some men with him. And verse 18 of chapter 30, of that same book of Samuel, it says that David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives. David was a fighter. He was a warrior. And even in those moments when he had lost it all, he didn't lose that spirit of a warrior. He never lost his focus. Thanks to his attitude. He kept a positive attitude. He knew that if God was with him, who can be against him? And I'm here to tell you, church, this morning, that God is with us. You believe it? Do you believe it? Stand to your feet this morning. Do you believe that God is with you? Then everything that the Lord has promised, he's going to make it true. It's going to happen. The key here is to follow David's example. You need to keep that spirit of a warrior. Don't give up. Keep fighting. Because he that promised is faithful. Don't lose focus. Stay focused. Stay focused on the promise. Can you just imagine everything David was going through? I didn't even read that scripture. But the Bible says in this story that even his own men were ready to stone him. They wanted to kill him. But David stayed focused on the promise. What promise? You're going to recover everything back. Everything the devil stole, you're going to recover it. Brothers and sisters, friends, what has the devil taken from you? What has the devil taken from you? I'm here to tell you this morning, get ready. Because God is about to begin to work in your life. If you trust Him, if you believe in Him, and you maintain a warfare spirit or warrior spirit in you, a positive attitude, you too, you can also recover everything. And God is about to begin to work in your favor. And the promises of God are amen. They're true. It's going to happen. How many believe that what you've lost, God's going to give it back to you? He is. Why do you say that, Pastor? Because God's word says it. Because God has said it. And God is not a man that he would lie. And I believe God's word. Do you believe God's word this morning? If you believe God's words, I want you to lift up your hands to heaven. The enemy can take everything from you except your dreams, your promises. But you got to take action. Because people who live in despair of what was lost never take action. The devil can't steal your dream unless you allow him to, by not doing anything. And your life will be a nightmare. So it's time to take action, church. God wants to give you everything back that the devil has taken from you. But he wants you to take action. He wants you to fight. He wants you to stay positive. He wants you to pray. He wants you to move forward. Go. Pursue. Pursue the enemy. There's anyone here this morning that have lost something? Has the devil taken your joy? Has he taken your peace? You're not able to sleep at night. You're just thinking about your problems. If the devil has taken your health, you're battling certain illnesses that you don't understand what's happening. That's the devil stealing your good health. Maybe the devil has taken your child. It's time to pursue the devil. And tell the devil, I'm taking back what belongs to me. This altar's for you. If the devil has taken your ministry, has he taken your calling? Or has he stopped you from working in God's kingdom? It's time to take back what the devil has taken from you. If there's someone here this morning that feels that the devil has taken something from you, and believe this word that has been spoken, that it's time to recover it, this altar is open for you. Come and receive God's blessing in Jesus' name. As our worship team leads us in a song of worship for a few moments, come this morning. God is speaking to someone this morning. This is a time to believe God. Trust God. Jesus' name.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never. Thank you. is my confidence. You never fail me, yeah. You never fail me, Jesus. You never fail me. Cause you're my King. You're my King, Jesus. Come on, lift up your hands and say, King of glory.
Lift it up to heaven one more time. you, Lord. We bless you, Father. We love you for all your goodness and mercy. Thank you for your word. We receive this word. I receive this word, Lord. Thank you for speaking to my life. And I'm claiming those promises, Father. Things that the devil has taken even from my life, Lord. I'm taking it back in Jesus' name. We're taking it back. Why? Because it belongs to me. You gave it to me, God. It's mine. I'm going to fight for it. I'm going to, until I see it happen. I'm not stopping, Lord, until every single thing the devil has taken, it's back in my possession. In Jesus' name, we claim it. How many say amen this morning? Clap your hands unto the Lord. We want to thank our visitors that have been with us this morning. God bless you. God bless you. At this time, so that we redeem the time. I know that as we've been, runs quick, but it's a very important thing that we need to do next. So I'm going to invite you to have a seat, please. We're going to move on, transition to what's next. And God bless our visitors. Just let our visitors know you don't have to stay for this meeting. There's the cafeteria or the food area. You're welcome to join us for a breakfast taco this morning. You're welcome to go to the next building or next to the gym, and they will be serving there's food there for if you would like to have a good breakfast, homemade tortilla.